And welcome to Between Two Wall Balls with Steve and Jamie, a.k.a. Turf Time. Okay, so Jamie and I decided to do a little video. We don't know if we're going to post it in Nine Versus group that's going on right now or if we're going to post it in Clean Kitchen or both. But we were talking the other day, and basically this first talk is going to be about...
the death of my latte.
Okay, so... My first question is,
well, let's just talk about
why the death of your latte, because okay. Let's just get real, like, latte is life.
Latte, right? Was life to me, and let's get this straight. This has been about a 5-year process of the death of my latte. Way back when, I used to get 2 medium sugar-free vanilla lattes. Before at Starbucks and then Java Mo's
opened. If you had a choice right now, where would you go?
Java Mo's.
So note to self, go to Java Mo's over Starbucks.
Java Mo's. And I would get one on my way into the gym, like before the 8 a.m. class. I would leave my house early just so I could go through the drive-thru, get the coffee, sip it before I would work out. And then I would get one when I left after coaching in the afternoon. And those were my warm hugs. Like, that was, like, my moment, you know. That was, I loved it. We would, you know, post on Instagram and Facebook about how much we loved our lattes.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Okay, so.
Long story short. I ended up getting an eye twitch, and I'm pretty positive. Well, you were actually the one that said it's probably all those damn lattes that you're drinking.
Well,
because
I was worried about the amount of caffeine.
Yeah, and the artificial sweetener, because I was using the sugar free stuff. And so, anyways, and then about that time, actually, Brian was getting these headaches.
Was it the Bang drinks he was drinking?
No. Okay. This is before that. Okay, this is, he was using Splenda in his coffee. Like, but he was drinking a bunch of cups and, you know, putting a lot of packets, you know, over a course of a day. Mm-hmm. And so I said, you know, Steve may know something, like have something
some
on
random
this.
Facts and knowledge. About
yeah. That. So I'm like, all right, it's probably like too much caffeine and too much sugar free. But my eye twitch was chronic. I'm talking every 30 minutes, the thing would go off. I would be working out, and it's just like.
Maybe you should get really close to the camera.
It's going off right now, actually. And it's because I haven't been getting a lot of sleep.
Okay.
And anyway, but it was just ongoing, and I'm like, this is weird, and it's not right.
So that was kind of the
That was the first, like, hey, I need to make some kind of changes. Some kind of variable needs to change for this app twitch to go away.
Because
something's causing it. And so I was like, fine, I'll give up my latte for 2 weeks. I said, I'll give it 2 weeks.
And secretly you were praying that in 2 weeks it would still be there and not make a difference so you could keep the latte in your life.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Exactly.
Yes. But you know what happened? The latte after 2 weeks not having it, the eye twitch did get substantially better. And so that was my first, like, then I started, I was like, maybe it's too much of the caffeine. Like, that Java Mo's latte was too much caffeine. I just needed to switch to what I called the mock latte.
Which was what?
That was regular coffee, just like, you know, brewed coffee, half milk in my mug, half coffee, and a little bit of stevia.
Okay,
I started doing stevia.
This is kind of where you could get into the argument of, like, that you don't really even like coffee. Because you're putting milk and stevia and creamer and unicorn flakes.
Yeah. Because if I liked coffee, I'd like the bitter black stuff. And to this day, I don't drink.
So
I'm black.
You're not?
I ain't black.
Okay, so no black coffee.
No, ever, never.
Ever.
Ever, because so it's like a treat. It's
okay,
like a,
do you still drink coffee today?
Yeah, one cup.
And what do you put in it?
Cashew milk. Almond creamer, and that's it.
Cashew milk and almond creamer?
Yes.
Okay.
And that is it. And But before, so the mock latte, yeah. I drank for a couple of years. You know, it was in the morning. I'd make it myself. I saved some money, you know.
Yeah, because those mediums are like $4.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, saving money.
$8 a day, yeah. Times 5 days a week. You're spending $40 a week times 4 weeks. $160 a month.
That was impressive.
You're welcome.
Yeah. So I started doing the mock latte. And I did that for about 2 years or whatever. But then I started noticing that I wasn't feeling good. Mm-hmm. Like, I was still drinking one in the morning, one in the afternoon. And so I started noticing that I wasn't feeling that well after my afternoon coffee. And I'm like, you know, I didn't understand why, because I'd always done mm-hmm. this. Like, it had never affected me before. But so I had to look at what I was doing. I was like, what do I do consistently every day? What do I eat yeah. every day that could possibly be a factor? And so I was like, you know, I started feeling bad. My stomach would hurt. I would get really bloated and like really gassy and, you know, just uncomfortable.
Just a real pleasant peach to be around.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was like, there's something that I consistently do that is contributing to this. So I was like, you know, looking at all like food allergies and, you know, stuff like that. Then one of the number one things is dairy. And I'm like,
great. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I was like, they're going to take away my latte. Finally. So anyway, so then I was like, all right, I'll try almond milk. Well, that was a sad, sad day. And I started doing almond milk, and then I would do almond milk in my little mock latte, and I tried it for a few days, and I did feel a lot better.
Yeah.
And then I was like, well, maybe I'll just try my milk just one time, and just see what happened. And then it went immediately back to the way I was feeling. So I was like, dang it, there's the culprit. Well, so I went on for a couple of weeks, but I still wasn't 100%.
Yeah.
I was still...
So you were basically just saying, like, I'm not letting this go.
Yes, I was still
like
wasn't...
Like, the death of your latte was sad.
Yeah, it was a very sad
And it was a very long process.
It was over years. And then I figured out I was using stevia so much, and you can create
an allergy to stevia?
Yeah, a sensitivity to stevia. I looked it all up. It's like stevanoids or something is what it's called.
Oh, my word. Okay.
Anyway, so then I had to give up the stevia.
So you couldn't have milk, you couldn't have stevia because you were basically doing...
I couldn't have artificial sweeteners.
Okay.
So it went, I couldn't have artificial sweeteners. Then I couldn't have milk. So then I did almond milk and stevia. Well, then Mother Nature's giving me the middle finger and said, you can't even have stevia. And you can't have that sweet goodness.
Every afternoon.
Every afternoon.
And every morning.
That you love.
So Mother Nature's trying to get you to drink Mother Nature, which is... black coffee.
Right. Yeah. But I still haven't given up.
The resistance.
I'm still resisting. So over the course of 5 years, it has gone in that order of I had to give up the bought latte, made my mock latte, had to give up the
milk.
The milk and the
stevia.
Like, yeah, artificial sweetener. Yeah. And then it moved to stevia. And then I had to give up stevia.
And so now you're
so
into...
now I'm just almond or cashew milk and almond creamer, no sweetener. And I'm fine about it. Like, I'm happy about it.
You sound real happy and fine about it.
But no, the first couple of months, I was real unhappy about it.
Yeah. Okay, so...
So let's get to the point.
So the whole death of your latte and the whole thinking of that, before we get to, like, the absolute point of it is, like, I guess, let's say, do you ever make choices that you don't want to make?
All the time.
Yeah, especially when it's for the betterment of yourself, because you said, hey, I identified a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And instead of just saying, because we see people all the time that go on this roller coaster ride of they don't get enough sleep. Well, say they sleep like 5.5 to 6 hours a night or whatever consistently.
Mm-hmm.
They don't get enough water. They don't exercise. And so when they wake up in the morning, they're completely spent.
Mm-hmm.
And so what do they need? Tons of caffeine.
Right.
So they drink tons of caffeine and gets them up. Then they crash in the afternoons because they don't have enough sleep. They don't move. They don't have enough water. They don't eat right. They need what again to get them up?
Caffeine
again. and then it keeps them up too late. And it's this vicious cycle over and over and over. But oh my gosh, no, it can't be that I'm not moving, not eating well, not drinking water, and not sleeping.
Right.
It has to be something else. Let me go see the doctor and get a pill kind of deal.
Right.
So what you're saying is what you did was you made a very difficult choice because you said it was your afternoon hug.
Yeah.
It's your moment of silence, like don't mess with mama while she's drinking her cup of coffee kind of deal.
Like Bishop says, if I'm in a bad mood, do you need your cup of coffee? And I'm like, yes, I do, but yeah. I can't have it because it makes me not sleep.
Yeah.
And so it makes me gassy.
giving up something for the good of self, yes, would be like a very big thing.
It's one, I think that is what health and fitness is.
Yeah.
It's all about the trade-offs. It's all about what you're willing to pay,
mm-hmm,
you know, the price you want to pay for something that your limiting factor or whatever it is,
yeah,
is keeping you from that, you know, goal or, you know, whatever it is that you want.
Yeah.
Like, you have to make a choice to get around what's blocking you.
Yeah.
And so the analogy and the reason we told the long story of the latte was that over the course of a 5-year period, I had to give up something that I was very attached to. You know, I have a version of it that doesn't affect me. It was a sad version, you know, at first. But now I'm totally fine with it because I feel so much better.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
But you wouldn't have known that if you never decided to say,
right,
like, hey, let me start breaking this down. Like,
yeah,
let me turn my back on it, turn a blind eye to it. No, it can't be that.
Right.
This thing is so awesome.
Right. And you find a lot of people do that in health and, you know, in fitness and trying to get in shape. It's,
yeah,
like they want to believe a lie.
Yeah.
You know, of
the 30-day cleanse and flush.
Yeah. Yeah. Or, you know, somebody that wants to get ripped in a month or,
yeah,
you know, whatever it is. It's like, oh, it couldn't be the other 10 months. You
it's
know,
gotta be this one.
It's gotta be this one, but I couldn't have started, you know, 6 months ago.
Yeah.
It's like nobody wants to admit that they're doing it to themselves.
Yeah,
you know?
True.
So, you know, so going back to like my dairy sensitivity, I love cheese. Love it. I would eat it every day if I could.
So like you're saying, in high school, you may go to a Mexican restaurant and order a bowl of cheese with a chicken and cheese quesadilla?
And pour it on top. By myself. But, you know, that was in the past. This is the present.
Don't bring up the old stuff.
I still eat dairy occasionally, but I pay the price.
Yeah.
And it is
it is
awareness that I have gained through that process of elimination. And like I've said before, awareness is a bitch.
Yep.
It can be. But, you know, when you go through all these processes through, you know, signing up for a boot camp or Clean Kitchen or the Iron Versus Challenge, you gain awareness of what you should be doing.
Yeah, and you're,
you know,
and like also when you sign up for something, like when you first started to give up your latte, like right in the beginning, and you started to give it up, I bet you felt just absolutely over the moon, happy, excited, and you felt good about it, and it was not a struggle at all, right?
Right.
Yeah. So when you first start something,
yeah,
it's not going to be rainbows and sunshine.
No.
Like, it's going to suck.
I was pissed.
Yeah.
I was, like, resistant, rebellious, like, name all of the things.
And stubborn.
Yes, because I went back to it. I was like, ooh, I'm just going to try it
you
again.
You went back to the crap that made you feel bad.
Yeah. Yeah, I went back just to see if it wouldn't. If it all falls wrong, you know.
Yeah.
But Mother Nature, again, she keeps reminding me that was the right choice,
yeah,
to go. So it's not about, you know, that sometimes we have to make choices and decisions every single day that we don't necessarily want to do,
yeah,
but it's going to benefit us.
And you know it's going to.
Yeah, and that's what makes it easier to make the choice.
Like, we don't really have to, like, get on a high horse and argue that being active and moving and coming to the gym 4 to 5 hours a week of activity. I'm not saying being in the gym 4 to 5 hours a week, but
like,
activity,
yeah,
4 to 5 hours a week, drinking water, eating plants and protein, and getting enough sleep is good for you. Like, we don't have to argue that. However, because there's,
right,
tons of science out there that says that that's,
right,
great, but for some reason, we still will go, stubborn. No, that can't be it.
We're stubborn.
It's not it. But you're getting 6 hours of sleep. Nah.
Yeah. Nah. Brian used to argue with me about the sleep. Like, I get up at, 4:30 every morning.
Yeah.
I got it timed, yeah. And how long it takes me to get to the gym and stuff. But I need to go to bed early.
Yeah, like 8:30 or 9.
And he's like, I don't need sleep. I can run on like 5-4 hours of sleep.
Yeah, get it.
And I'm like, fine, you go do that, but I'm not.
Let's see. I think let's hit the high points. So
okay. The
high points would be of this, like, do you ever get hangry and the hangriness leads to stubbornness? You already said, yeah, it does.
Yes.
Like, it leads us to being stubborn, even though we know that this thing is really good for us. So the death of your latte is actually a good thing for you.
Yes, it was. So, it was an emotional thing, like emotional driver versus the rational driver, This is classic, what we're talking about.
Like, your feelings of emotion are like a massive elephant.
Yes.
That have this little bitty rider on top, which is the rational side. And the rational side's trying to tell the emotional side, like, hey, this is good. And the guy's like, no, it's not.
No, it's not. I'm going to go do this that I want to do because I just want to do it.
Because that makes sense.
Yeah.
But so then, like, don't be stubborn would be a high point. Like, it's very hard to do, but there's a lot of proof out there that, like what she did, process of elimination style diets, really looking into
things.
May
take a long time. May take 5 years.
May take 5 years.
To actually accept it.
Yeah. So stubbornness is going to be there. So there will be resistance on anything that you first start, like no matter what it is, clean kitchen, doing any type of diet, doing any type of exercise program, whatever. Anything that's brand new, there's going to be that learning period or that gap that's hard to do. And then Jamie said this, I was taking a little bit of notes, but she said it a couple of times, but making choices that you don't want to make. Like, you know they're good for you, but you don't want to make them because they're hard. And you don't want to go through that process of, like,
the emotional attachment to whatever it is. It's pure stubbornness. You could call it laziness sometimes. I mean, all of us have those emotional days where we're just like, brain done, I can't do that, whatever it is. And it's totally cool to have those days, but be aware that that doesn't necessarily give
you... Are you still there? Okay. Hey! We had a phone call come in. Sorry.
It's still there. It's just being aware, being an adult, and not giving yourself an out.
Yeah,
like, it's okay to have a bad day. It's okay to, like, not eat all your plants, drink all your water, or skip a workout, if you feel like you need to. But it's not okay to say, that doesn't apply to me. You know what I mean? Like,
ultimate responsibility.
Yes.
Like, the buck stops here.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's nobody else's fault. It's, it may be somebody else's fault that puts you in a bad mood, but how you react to it is what's more important, and it'll, serve you better. It'll make you have a better outlook or, perspective on things. You try to find the silver lining. Like, I did not want to give up my latte, but over time it made me healthier.
Yeah. And feel better.
And feel better.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that was kind of in the short term because you said after almost immediately, like 2 weeks later, you started to feel better, but that's still 2 long weeks.
Yeah.
But
I started seeing, that was the eye twitch.
Yeah.
Then with the whole dairy sensitivity that I developed later, after a couple of days of giving it up, I was like, no.
Yeah.
No, don't do this to me.
Okay. And then another thing that I wrote down that you said earlier was everything costs something. So, like, if I'm like, dude, look, I'm going to binge on Netflix and chilling all night long because this new episode of whatever, Altered Carbon or something came out, and I'm going to binge watch it, Stranger Things, and like get caught up. But I stay up till 3 o'clock in the morning, and then I start skipping my workouts, and then I can't get my pull up, or my weight goes up by 5 pounds on the scale, or whatever it may be. Everything costs something.
Yes.
So I spent all my time watching Netflix or whatever it is, and I didn't invest it. So I spent my money instead of investing my money in myself. And so that can be ring true with the whole latte deal.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So
it's give and take, trade-offs. What do you want? Do you want it bad enough? And it's okay to not want something extreme, like an extreme goal. It doesn't have to be. We're talking in general.
Yeah.
You know, just like if you want to just feel good, you're going to have to make some choices that you already don't make right now that are probably uncomfortable to make order to get there.
Yeah, because like, so I don't remember if this, it was in a book that I read sometime or a podcast or something, but the guy was talking about, he's like, success leaves clues all the time. And then the other book that we read, the Switch book, it says look for bright spots.
Yeah.
Like hone in on bright spots. Yeah. Are you being summoned?
Nope.
So if success leaves clues, so you look around the gym and you find somebody, let's use you for an example, because we're talking about the death of your latte. Like, and I've seen your metamorphosis from when you started and you were pregnant and you had Bishop and you were not very active at all during that span. Like you were doing the boot camp kind of stuff.
I pulled a muscle in my stomach sneezing when I was pregnant. So I couldn't move. Because
you were so in shape.
I was in shape. I did boot camps before in Atlanta. And then when we moved, like, I wasn't super active when I was pregnant.
Yeah.
And then I pulled a muscle when I sneezed.
But
and
so if we go back to then, and not to, like, rehash your entire journey, because we could talk about that for, like, an hour. But
next one.
Yeah, the next one. Jamie's journey from fat to fit to fat to fit to fat to never again. But so if we look at that and you say success leaves clues, and we'll kind of wrap this up because I think we've gone a good bit. Yeah. But success leaves clues. Like, so looking at your situation, like when you started, you were not in the best of shape, right? Mm-hmm. And then
you made fun of my burpees.
I did. They were kind of floppies and not burpees. Mm-hmm. But so you started back in what?
2011. February of 2011.
And so now it's 2018. So you've been doing this gig for like 7 solid years. Mm-hmm. And over 7 years, like, you've made tremendous improvements, mm-hmm. but they've always been
small.
Like super small. Mm-hmm. But then when you get to where you get to I think that you're fairly fit now. And so when you get there and folks don't know you and they see you, they assume that you've been fit the entire mm-hmm. time. But it's been the little bitty trade-offs of everything costs something. So now when we first met and you were joining Versus and being a coach and all that kind of stuff, you didn't get up at 4:30 in the morning.
No.
But now you do, almost every day.
The Bellgrass class started at 5:45. Now it starts at 5:10.
Slowly.
We're slowly over, this will be year, wait,
six. Or seven. Yeah.
We'll be going into the seventh year. Slowly it has morphed into the 5:10 a.m. class. Hey-o. We are not giving up that 10 minutes.
But so it's those little bitty things, like we were saying, success leaves clues. So if you're like, hey, you know, I want to be a successful entrepreneur, then you better go seek out, like, one of the most successful entrepreneurs out there.
Yeah, what are they doing?
What are they doing? Mm-hmm. If you see somebody that's really successful in fitness or whatever it may be, like, hey, what are you doing?
Yeah, copy it or morph it to what your needs are.
And because that goes back to what you were saying earlier. We're not saying, like, aim for the moon and hit the stars or aim for the stars.
Like, you don't have to go that extreme.
Yeah, you don't have to go nuts. But, like, what we're saying is we know because there's tons of... the foundational stuff is sleep seven to 10 hours a night. I know that's for parents out there. Like, I get it.
I am versus people from today until your retest. You better be sleeping.
Yeah, sleep right now. Sleep. Why are you watching this? You can watch it later and listen to it. But foundational stuff of getting your sleep in, getting half your body weight in ounces of water today. The reason why we upped it to 100 ounces is because you're active. Mm-hmm. And when you're active, you sweat and you need to replace the fluid. Mm-hmm. So that's, you know, greatly acceptable. It's within the margin of error for sure. And then getting in plants and then getting in protein. Like, those are the foundational stuff. So if you know you're doing those things, then you can start looking at, man, I'm doing those things, but I still feel bad. Right. I have an eye twitch. Like, something's up.
Yeah.
And so then you know.
Process of elimination.
Process of elimination. You can get it.
And then, you know, same thing goes with progress. Like, so say you've been doing these same things, and you know they're foundational stuff. It's kind of like when we talk about level one versus level two people. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you may have been living at level one for a while, but your goals have changed. And you may not realize that you're expecting to have more, mm-hmm. but you're, like, still doing the same thing.
Yeah.
So then you're like, oh, wait, okay, so if I want to get a little further along the continuum of progress, I've got to change a factor. I've got to make a decision that I'm not making right now, and it might not be comfortable to me.
And that would be, like, that would be a good ending point, because it was definitely not comfortable for Jamie to kill her latte.
It wasn't, but it's A-okay. I'm okay with it now.
And maybe one day she'll be able to drink coffee.